Thank you very much, Arun, for introducing me here. And I'm very happy to be with Jami Linus. And thank you very much for inviting me here. I'd like to talk about what we may really call cultural memory. And I think, before one starts doing architecture, one has to understand one aspect of it, that it lasts longer than design. Design for fabric, design for pottery, design for chairs, design for anything else. Architecture design lasts for a much longer period and covers areas, regions, and space and time. So it's a sort of concern of the architect to be, let's say, a little bit more serious perhaps. It's a great task which comes into our aspect of design. So I'm just showing you this. I think, I hope some of you have seen it, or some of you probably have seen it. The first image from, let's say, Fatah Kusitri, and this, let's say, Rajasthan, in the fold looking down. Next. Again, another image from Udaipur, next. The temple in South India, Humayun Tomb, I've lived in front of it for many years, next. There's the Sanchi Stupa, and you can see Rashtrapati Bhavan, where that is, next. This is Corbusier's Secretariat in Chandigarh. So, give it to me, I think I have to handle this. This one is from, okay. So, I just introduced that these are something which gets ingrained in your mind, in your memory, when you are thinking of projects. So, let's say this is one of my first projects. Very lucky to win an architecture competition, and I was about 37 at that time, and I was told that if it cannot be built in a year and a half, well, your project will be taken away from it. So I had to work nearly, I don't know, 20 hours or 18 hours with four young architects to make it work, and I think Arun went with me at that time, you should remember what happened. I hope most of you may have ever seen this project, built in 1972, and it's one of the largest space frame structure in concrete, and built with very basic labor. It's not an industrial design, people just pour concrete in a particular manner. You can see, and I'm surprised that most architectural historians have covered it in their books, and also, let's say, the Pompidou Museum is showing it as a major work of both structure and architecture in their current exhibition. Now, immediately when I was doing it, I was asked to do another project, which was it's sort of memorial to Nehru, if you like. And this posed a very difficult problem for me, because I was to do major work and at the same time to think about something totally different. So in this case, I came about an idea which I'd seen in Nepal, a sort of grass mound to have relics of Buddha. So I thought it'd be a good idea if we had, let's say, grass mound to honor Nehru, who would have hated anything of pomposity. So the idea was to honor a man, and the idea that children can just run up and down this grass mound is a sort of a gender memorial to a great statesman. You can see the plan. If it reminds you of some young grass, it's almost accidental, because that's the way I thought of it. This is one of the models which was there in the Pompidou Museum at the moment. You can see some of the interiors. Let's say after that, I had about 6 to 7 years of practically no work, but a lot of thinking and teaching, which I think is always very good. Because if you don't want to compromise about what you're doing, I think you can have hiatus or stop areas, and I think that can be well utilized for thinking. And this is the Asian Games Village. Again, I won this from an architectural competition. But during the period, I have been traveling, and I was one of the first to go to Jessen there. And I was absolutely stunned by the great architecture, urbanism, design, and all aspects of it. But particularly, how in a very hot climate you could work out where it would be really cool and pleasant, so to speak. Now, this resulted in a kind of design, which is of course very different Asian Game Village. The idea was that you have pedestrian paths interwoven into the design, and the parking is all left on the, let's say, on the periphery of the design. So this is the kind of architecture which came about, came with very fast in about 2.5 years. Now, this is the streets of Jaisalmer. You can see the shadow is inbuilt into it. When the temperature is well above 45 degrees, it's the kind of response of the building to the climate. This is the kind of, let's say, images we, let's say, seen in the Asian Game Village. You can see the pedestrian paths running through the buildings, and on the periphery, you can see the ground and which goes underneath the buildings. Small clusters, smaller courtyards. So the whole form is based on having a sort of a climatic, let's say, which responds to the climate and certain cultural values. Now this image from Rajasthan, I think shows something very valuable which we are losing. The lifestyle almost on the roof. Let's say during the day if you could sleep, if it's very hot, if it's not air conditioned, evenings are much more present. So I tried to have some of those values in a completely different medium. This resulted in later projects, National Institute of Immunology, which is a, on the almost on the ridge of Delhi, next to KNU, and I suggest young designers to have it, go and look at it, because I think it's very easy to understand how you, when you go around, how the land itself, the spaces are integrated into the design. The rocks on the side are a part of the design, how to diffuse the light, how an architecture can be very quietly woven with not only the spaces, but also the materials that they were on the side. These are the small courtyards. Again, lessons learned from Jaisalmer and other cities of Rajasthan. And you can see the kind of spaces which are built into the side. I'm showing you the series of courtyards because courtyard is almost a very integral part of the historic tradition of India, not only here but also in the Mediterranean cultures, Italy, Spain, etc. And I think the high rocks which are being built, I'm afraid, would have serious sustainability problems in some ways. You can see the kind of spaces and the life which is created in it. Now that's another project I'd like to show because you can see the Kutabel one end of it. This is one project in which I started experimenting with stone, sandstone, which is a very Indian material. I mean, we are maybe along with Italy and perhaps Portugal, one of the few countries in the world which had built in stone and built very well in stone. I mean, some of the greatest buildings built in stone are in India. And it was, when I started my professional career, I was amazed that nobody was using stone. So I started to find a vocabulary in which stone became an integral part of the design. And you can see in this one sections and again built around the courtyard, how the stone in combination with the concrete became a kind of a design element. You can see concrete and stone. And now the stone here is used as a cladding material, really to reflect the heat, provide extra insulation. And here you can see the beginning entrance hall. Now, this is a major project you may well have seen. This was a big jump for me, both in terms of scale and kind of work. But again, the building has a very large span, and let's say the vertical support, these veneer girders. I could maybe give only a lecture only on this building, because again, this is the kind of work which would be very difficult to do in Europe and America. But the sort of creativity in terms of what can be done here, because we have a cheaper craft, etc. Now you can see elephants here. This is the kind of thing looking the building. You can see long span structure becomes the facade of itself becomes a kind of a sunbreaker. Again, this project again being shown in the museums all around in Europe, both in Parma and Italy first, and now in Paris. Now, this is, you may say, an inspiration from the Paris of Dacia. Again, a fantastic Paris. I would suggest all the designers to go and have a look at it. I mean, after Fateh Pur Sikri, an amazing sense of space on the right hand side of it. So, as a curator for the exhibition, I was asked to measure it and some of these drawings which we made in the office. And suddenly I had an office design competition which resulted on the left side of it, which is in a way inspired by it, but totally different in terms of looks. Again, using sandstone. And the form of the building itself becomes kind of a diffuses sunbreakers. It's one of the few first air-conditioned buildings in Delhi, and it cut down the air-conditioning cost by nearly 35%, which I think is a major achievement of the building itself. You can see the interiors of it, the space within it. Another project, very different, Indian National Science Academy. I wanted to sort of give a feel, or as I used the word NASA, of a sort of very dynamic building which can sort of, in a way, represent Indian science going ahead. I don't know if it really does, but that's what I thought would be a good idea for it. This is a section of it. You can see now the building also has both roof terraces and jutting out mast, which creates shadows and reduces the temperature. This is an interesting project. We won the international competition with the invited from our client for the world's five leading architects. And while doing it, I was very impressed by this particular church in Lisbon called Geronimo. And you can see the strong geometrics and the kind of light it has. And I think that somehow permeated in my design. Now, one thing I was very lucky in Portugal was because we have also, like India, still good craftsmen and granite, which can be very easily prefabricated, and so this is really a structure in which the granite, which is very strong in compression, and steel in tension, are sort of fletched together or fused together to form a structural system. I use the global stone for the Oshisi Kandu marble in its sedimentary form to express itself. Now you can almost embrace the building's elevation derived from Indian stone jalis, which very frankly expressed there, but the scale was very different. It may be, it was given a prize there as one of the largest stone structure ever built, and in the Iberian Peninsula, both Barcelona and I think the jury from Madrid sort of considered its volume and structural systems innovative. I think to talk about innovation, I need another 1 hour to explain all aspects of it. But let's say the tradition is, I have always said when talking to other students, you know, you cannot marry your grandmother. You have to just take an inspiration to go ahead. And this is the kind of thing which you can work out with. A very large span of structures, domes which are prefabricated, ferro cement shells, again, in which we have great expertise in India, more than anywhere else in the world. You can see the roof structure, the design of it, the interior volumes are lined with stone tiles, which became part of the permanent shuttering of the concrete. You can see the quality of light which goes into the building. I was almost reminded when I was thinking of this project, the mosque in Gulbarga, I don't know if many of you have seen it, it's a fantastic mosque with a play of light on arches. So this is when you're designing, something like that comes through your mind and it results in something very different. This is the materials done by my son, who was a computer. And you can see some of the details. This is the charbar, and this is the structural system. I think the detail of how to weave stone with stainless steel is again done perhaps for the first time in large architecture work. I come back to a very major work, I hope you get to see it. The Library for the Indian Parliament. This was a major challenge, how to be in harmony with both Indians and Lakers, and also in a way to contradict, because Indians went on record to say that they were building it to show in India the superiority of Western art, science and culture. So it was very much in my mind how to handle that. I mean, I had to be in harmony, but at the same time, I took the inspiration that all right, it's an imperial outburst, but so I relied on Jain temples and Buddhist monuments, which are more inner looking, in interior space. And so this is the kind of, let's say, you can see the Lakers drum and the building which on the side, but the idea of how to relate with it and was based almost the kind of plans which are in Angkor Wat, etc., inner spaces. So instead of having an outer veranda, which is very, in a way, you could even consider it a little pompous perhaps, but here is the inner circulation which goes through smaller courtyards of a very different type. And in this building, I wanted to symbolize aspects of each courtyard, parts of Indian democracy, the idea of enlightenment, equality, etc. This is the again from temple from Udaipur. You can see the small courtyard, and this is the kind of right in quality. So let's say to the tall columns, the roof of the building is almost aligned with the base of the columns, but inside it has a totally different ambience. And I think this is a very mind way of responding to the parliament, that this building eventually become the guru of the parliament, because that is the purpose of the library. And this is very much a sort of metaphor in my mind while designing, let's say, the idea of water, which treats everybody as an equal. I mean, it's the first sentence somewhere in the Rig Veda. And I think some of these thoughts come into your mind when you're designing these things. And these are the sort of deeper aspects of design in architecture. You can see the entrance hall. Again, from this temple in Udaipur, near Udaipur, you can see the roof elements. This is the entrance hall looking after the roof. And this is again another space within which, how we bring the light within the building to symbolize enlightenment. You can see these structural elements. Design. See the details of the structure. So put it like that, the ancient ideas of, let's say, which come from philosophy, from maybe moral values, I was going to use the word religion in a secular way, all comes into play when we're doing great sort of architectural themes and how to tackle that. Oh, this is maybe an interesting canvas. The university is in Rota and is for visual arts, let's say fashion design, architecture, urbanism, film. So sort of creative arts. But my starting point in this one was these things of Sarnath, Taxila, and Nalanda. These were the earliest universities which we had built, which were most of them are sort of have been destroyed and demolished. But I thought somehow the feel of this should be reflected in one university which I was going to do. So I'm just showing very quickly the images of that. And beside this you see in both Parma, where they had immediate exhibition of my work, and also in Bologna, in Italy. So this sort of inspiration values, how this is the oldest university of the world, in Europe. I mean, we had Taxila and Nalanda before that. This is Oxford and Cambridge. Part of my memory of being a student in London. So this is the sort of Google image I'm showing to you. And this is what resulted in this particular university. What you see is slanting images are not only the symbol of, let's say, Dharma Chakra perhaps, or something like that, but basically these are photovoltaic panels which are inclined in a manner. The idea is that the entire university's requirements for power are generated by these photovoltaic panels. I think this is the plan of it, but the different institutes are really four individual quarters, but the central part is, and this is the model of it, first early model. You can see how the project goes through different phases of design. There is a foyer center space between the building. This is the image seen from the top. You see this, the three circles and the quadrangles around, which are spaces which intermingle with each other, and the students can really use it. there is a sunken seminar room, etc. And you can see the building in progress. I'm rushing it through. This is a small amphitheater done with steel and glass, and but open to natural ventilation. You can see the staircase going up to the roof, where there is another surrounding room for the fashion students. I hope some of you can teach or work there. This is one of the most ambitious university for creative arts. The students in the School of Architecture and Urbanism. How the sunken code is being used. You can see from the library, which is the highest on the roof of the balcony of the library, with the view of what is inside. This is the foyer of the Fashion Institute. Perhaps, as somebody may say, many of the forms inspired by observatory. I'll take you to one more project which is under construction in Calcutta, and in a way very different. Here, maybe inspired by the observatory, but the whole project is an office block. But the idea is that the photovoltaic panels used in this form entirely generate the power, except for air conditioning, almost all. This is the plan of it. This is sections. You can see the early models. I'd like to just say two words. I think we are living in times which the only thing constant is the change. That's been said by other people before me. And we have to respond to it very as creatively as we can. And I think this is the challenge to all architects, all designers, in every field. So with that, I say thank you very much.